Hi there. My name is Tristan Scroggins. I'm a mandolin player living in Nashville, Tennessee. We're going to talk about how to learn a song from a recording. There's lots of great reasons to learn a song from a recording. One of them is that bluegrass has this sort of unique aspect to it in that almost all of its history is recorded and accessible, and so much of what is being created nowadays is based on older recordings. So there's a lot of value that can be gained from going back to really old recordings and sort of seeing the roots of where things came from, but there's also a lot of value in learning things from newer recordings. When you learn something note for note, and not just note for note like you could off of a sheet music, but note for note in that you're learning it by ear, you're learning that player's expression of the tune, and everybody has a unique voice on their instrument and something unique that they bring to a tune. Part of our goal as musicians is to be able to express ourselves through music, and we have to develop that voice. It can feel pretty foreign pawing at an instrument and trying to get something that feels like an expression of us to come out. But learning other people's expressions by ear, you can sort of hear those more subtle nuances of tone and timing and texture and dynamics and all sorts of other things that make music what it really is, which you can't always learn off of a page. So the first thing to do, obviously, is going to be to pick a tune to learn. And I think we'll work with St. Anne's Reel. It's a great beginner sort of tune, very common, lots of people know it, lots of fun to play. Once you have a tune in mind, you're going to need to find a recording. And this can be a little daunting. Like I said, the entire music's history is recorded, essentially. And while that's a great asset, it also means there's lots of recordings of popular songs. So if you just do a search for St. Anne's Reel, a lot of different things are going to come up, and it's going to be difficult to figure out which things are going to be worth spending time with. Like with all learning, I think setting a goal is really important. When you're learning tunes, I think that there are kind of two broad ways that you can go. On the one hand, if you're wanting to go out and jam with people, then you're going to want to learn versions of the tune that other people are going to know, things that are going to be recognizable, and things that are going to be able to be played with other people, because that's the goal, is to play with other people. On the other hand, we have our own personal enjoyment, and so we might learn something that we might not get the chance to play with other people because we don't know somebody who knows it, or it's too complicated to call in a jam, but it brings us a lot of joy. And so we learn something just because we want to. In this case, I'm going to stick with learning a version of the tune that's pretty straightforward, so that if I go out into a jam and want to call St. Anne's Reel, I know that I'm going to play a version that other people know. Some things to look out for, especially with popular tunes and songs, is that since there are so many versions, a lot of people will add a lot of their own interpretation to it, and that can sometimes make it unrecognizable to somebody else who hasn't heard that recording. And a lot of times in bluegrass, what'll happen is that a band will have a really popular recording that some people will play in jams, and other people will play an older version of it. An example of this might be with the really popular recording of Man of Constant Sorrow, which was featured in the Coen Brothers movie, Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? That version was performed by a band that now goes by the Soggy Bottom Boys, and it sounds like this.
In constant sorrow through his day, I am the man of constant sorrow.
But an older version of it in bluegrass would be the Stanley Brothers recording, which sounds like this. While it's the same song, they're performed in a very different way. In a jam situation, you would just clarify ahead of time what version or what vibe you were trying to go for. With a tune, there can be lots of different interpretations of tunes, such as this version of Down in the Willow Garden. in this version of Down in the Willow Garden. Even though it's the same tune, you could see how if somebody called it and they played these two different versions, they might not line up. The best way to solve this problem, if you're looking for learning something that other people will know, is to ask other people. If you go to a local jam and somebody calls a tune that you think is cool and you want to learn it from a recording, you want to go home and learn it, you should just ask somebody where they learned it from. And sometimes they might not have an answer, but a lot of times they'll have a version that they can recommend to you, because if they like the song enough to learn it, then they probably listen to it. And that way, you'll at least be on the same page as somebody else. Otherwise, a little bit of research might be involved. You can spend a little bit of time on the internet sort of researching popular versions of tunes and trying to figure out what the original melodies of things are, but that also gets pretty murky with when you go back to older versions, they sound a lot different than the newer versions that other people play. So for this, I picked a version from Bluegrass 96, which is from a series of records. The first record was called Bluegrass 95. It was a pun on Windows 95. And then the next year they did another record and they called it Bluegrass 96. And they made a dozen or so of those records. They feature a lot of really common tunes played usually in a pretty straightforward way, as well as some less common tunes and some original tunes. But the common tunes, such as St. Anne's Reel or Whiskey Before Breakfast, Patty on the Turnpike, those are all usually pretty straightforward versions. On Bluegrass 96, we have Wayne Benson playing mandolin. Wayne played for a long time in Third Time Out, and he's a great mandolin player and great teacher. And so we're going to, since I play the mandolin, I'm going to mostly focus on his solo here. I'm going to show you how to use YouTube to slow down a recording. There are other ways that you can slow down recordings and software that you can download. If you're looking for software, I would recommend the Amazing Slow Downer. They have an app that's available on the Google Play and Apple App Store that is pretty inexpensive and really useful, and it has Spotify integration, and so it's what I use most of the time, but YouTube has a built-in slow down feature that is really useful. And even though it's a little tedious, I think that's actually kind of nice to have to put in a little bit of effort. It's kind of like how people, before we had this technology, would have to get a record and then put a nickel on top of it so it would spin slower so they could learn it, and they'd have to tune their instrument down to accommodate for it. In this case, we don't have to do anything like that. We're just going to have to click back a few times as we repeat the slowed down parts of the tune. All right, so we're going to click play and the video is going to load up. And then we're going to go down into the right-hand corner once the video started playing, and there's a little gear symbol here. That's the settings. We click that, and we're going to scroll up. It says playback speed, which is right now set to normal. Once we click that, you'll see there's other options. Let's click 0.75. You'll see the video is playing at 75% of the speed that it was before. We can go back and click on 25% to get it really slow. And then if we want it to go back to normal, we just click on playback speed again, and then click normal. So we can do the same thing with YouTube video on our phone. If you're in the YouTube app, you can go and click on a video that you want. I think we'll do 49 Cats in a Rain Barrel. Then if you just touch where the video is once, it'll bring up this display, and in the upper right-hand corner, there's three dots. If you click those, you'll see there's a playback speed option here as well, and so we can slow this down to 75%. Click it again, and we can do 25%. Click it again, and we can go to normal speed again. So let's pull up the tune and listen to it. Now let's find the part of the song that has the solo that we're looking for. We're looking for the mandolin solo. So I'm gonna, there it is. We're going to want to have this playing right before the solo starts, and we're gonna wanna keep that number in mind. So let's go to the solo before and listen for the end of it. So the mandolin solo is starting around 1:40. We're going to keep that in mind because we're going to be going back to that a lot. So I'm going to move the cursor to just a little bit before 1:40 so that we have some lead in going into it. So we'll go for 1:35. We'll just give ourselves 5 seconds and I'll click it. And then I'll go to the settings and I'll change the playback speed to, I like to actually start with 0.75%. so that I can hear still the vibe of what's being played, and if it's going by too fast, I'll slow it down. But for right now, why don't we go to 50%? And then we'll hit play. So we're getting ready for the mandolin solo to come up. So that's about where it starts to repeat. This tune, like a lot of tunes that we'll end up playing, has a structure that we usually refer to as AABB. There's an A part and a B part to this tune. We play the A part twice and the B part twice. It'll be easiest if we just go by through this at least just a section at a time so that we have a better chance of retaining. And if we need to break it down into smaller chunks, measure by measure, we can. But for right now, we're just going to stick with 1A section. So we're going to roll back to, we'll say 1:38. 1:35 is a little bit too much. And then we'll get our instrument. Now, if you are totally unfamiliar with this tune or anything about this tune, the first thing you're going to need to know is what key it's in. And that's pretty important to figure out. The way that you figure out the key that a song is in is almost always the last chord that is played is almost always the key that it's in. There's lots of other ways to figure it out, but that's the simplest way. And so we're ending this fiddle solo. And so if we listen to it, we can try to move around on our fretboard and try to figure out where it's ending. It's sounding a lot like D. And so we know that we're in the key of D. And that's gonna help because then you're gonna know sort of what notes you're gonna mostly be working with. So let's go back to our beginning. And if you kind of set your cursor on the scrub bar of where that's clicking by showing the time that's passing, just where you need to, where you're gonna start, then you can just sort of press down on the mouse pad just when you need to go back. I'm going to slow it down to 25%, and then I'm going to play along with the notes, and I'm going to be looking for those notes. You don't need to find them right away because you're going to go back and replay this over and over again, so you're kind of at the same time listening for what is the right note and remembering it for the next time. It's a really good way to learn something because you're having to memorize it while you're learning it. So I'm going to go through it a couple of times playing along, and you can sort of see that process. Okay, so that was my first pass through, and you could hear I was kind of, since they were going by so slow, there was a lot of time for me to figure out if I was playing where I was thinking the notes were going to go, and if I was right, then I was right. If I wasn't right, then I looked for where that note was and tried to figure it out. And because I've been doing it for a long time, I can usually hear the distance between the note that I guessed and the note that it actually is, which helps me get to that actual note. But when you're just first starting out, a lot of times it's going to be really frustrating because it just sort of sounds like a random note that you didn't have a guess for. But I promise that with messing around and trying to find that right note, that it's like a muscle, it'll just develop over time. So I kind of got the feel for it at 25%, so I'm actually going to speed it up again to 50% for this next run through, and so let's see what we get. Get it cute. So you can see how each time I'm remembering, sometimes I'm making the same mistake each time, but over time it's getting closer and closer to that version of what's actually happening. And so if I was going to keep doing this, I probably would just keep it on a loop and keep doing that until I got comfortable with that section. And usually the game or rule that I have for myself is that if it's something that's broken into increments like 25%, 50%, 70%, whatever, then I want to be able to play it perfectly three times in a row at whatever speed I'm at before I move it up to the next speed. In the case of this song, because it's not super complicated and that's such a short amount of time, I think it's 10 seconds, I would probably, since I felt pretty comfortable there at 50% speed and the thing that's coming next is another A part, it's not going to be a whole different tune or melody, I would probably work on both A parts at 50% speed until I got it to where I could play it perfectly three times in a row. Then I would move up to 75% speed. Then we would move on to the B part of the tune and it would just be the same process. It's a similar and related melody that usually ties back into the A part, but it's different. So a lot of times what happens is we spend a lot of time working on the B part and we've forgotten about the A part. So usually you might have to go back and forth a few times. And usually I'll try to get them both up to 75% speed. There's something about full speed that's a lot different than the slowed down speeds. Then you're really getting the actual human feeling of it, and that's a whole different level. And so you really need to start to feel comfortable with all those different things and kind of keep them in your mind before you practice them up to full speed. Otherwise, if you're practicing something wrong, you're just reinforcing bad habits, and we don't want that. Learning something through recording is kind of a tedious process, but it's a really valuable thing to do. It teaches us a lot about our instrument, a lot about more than just playing those notes, but about expressing ourselves. It's especially valuable if you learn multiple different versions of a tune from recordings, because you can see how they connect and how they're sort of different, and then you can start to make choices about how you want to make things different while still learning something that you can play with other people, that other people are going to be familiar with, and we can have a community where we play music together, which is why we all do this. I mentioned that I do a lot of transcribing and learning things by ear, and that's partly because I have a Patreon page where I started learning tunes for my own amusement and to play with other people in jams, And when I learn something by ear, I like to transcribe it anyway. So at a certain point, I started just putting those transcriptions up on Patreon, which is like a subscription sort of service where you can, you know, subscribe for a certain amount of money. The most popular amount is $5. With $5, you get access to one transcription a month, but also a whole back catalog of transcriptions. A lot of people have a $20 subscription a month where they have access to everything. So at this point, it's something like almost like 100 tunes or something, all these transcriptions. There's also a bunch of lesson videos up there as well. We do a monthly live stream, that sort of thing. I think that learning tunes is a lot of fun, and I think that playing tunes with other people is a lot of fun, so I like helping people along that process. I'm really happy to get to make this video for Bluegrass Pride. It's such a great organization. I'm sad that we didn't get to do the float and everything this year. I've been there for all of the floats so far, but next year or the year after, whenever it does happen again, I'll look forward to meeting all of you in person there.
Hello. This is Tristan, but from the future. This is me interjecting because I forgot to say that you should definitely donate to Bluegrass Pride if that's something that you are in a position to be able to do. Or just give a like on their Facebook page. Whatever you can do helps. It's a really great organization, and I'm really proud of all the work that they've done. Okay, back to me from the past.
Good luck learning some recordings.